Good morning, all, and welcome back from what I hope was a restful and much-needed break from a most unusual and taxing fall semester. To be sure, we were all exhausted when it was done, but we prevailed successfully thanks to everyone's efforts and hard work. In reflecting on the past 7 or 8 months, what I continue to find most challenging and wearing is not the increased amount of work that our remote environment continues to demand, but rather the growing sense of isolation that I'm experiencing as time passes. Isolation from faculty, from students, staff, and administrative colleagues who make up our FIT community, a community that definitely sustains us in all sorts of ways when we are physically present together on 27th Street. In this regard, one cannot overestimate the importance and power of that physical presence, that sense of community, and its ability to get us through the tough times, if only by reassuring us that we are all hauling the same weight together. Yes, we are able to use technology to teach, to meet, and to get our business done. But Google Meet is only a marginally adequate substitute for that impromptu in-person conversation, that casual cup of coffee that so often results in a fresh idea, a solution to a problem, or an emotional pick-me-up that ends up getting us through the day. So as we assemble together to begin yet another semester working from afar, I have a thought to share. Perhaps each of us could find a path towards offsetting that sense of isolation by taking the opportunity each day to make a casual connection with a student or a colleague, to extend an encouraging thought, or to ask how they're getting along. And in doing so, keep our sense of community strong as we push through the challenges that we will surely encounter. As you will hear in some of my remarks that follow, our faculty, staff, and students are continuing to accomplish interesting and exciting things in spite of the additional challenges. Maintaining a strong sense of community and connectedness will only reaffirm that their accomplishments and hard work are acknowledged and appreciated. And in keeping with the theme of accomplishments, let me begin by sharing some news from Academic Affairs, which will then be followed by welcoming remarks from our Faculty Senate President Calvin Williamson, and of course from President Brown as well. Our work continues in preparation for our upcoming Middle States self-study and visit. Faculty, staff, and student work on the self-study document is progressing steadily, with working groups focused on collecting and analyzing documents that provide evidence as to how FIT is meeting Middle States standards. This spring, the groups will complete first drafts of their chapters, one for each of the 7 Middle States standards, in preparation for sharing and discussing the document with the FIT community this coming fall. As you may already know, our Office of International Programs, in collaboration with FIT's Cultural Fellows and the History of Art Department, launched a new initiative this past fall called Globally Connected at FIT, which offers a series of 45-minute virtual conversations led by students, faculty, and alumni to advance global education at FIT in our new world without mobility. The major themes of the thoughts thus far have been fashion, art, sustainability, racial equity, and life during the pandemic around the world. Helen Gaudet and Alexander Nagel have co-organized the events with student cultural fellows Siti Daga, currently in India, Anya Swap, who's currently in Jamaica, and Audrey Matiandi and Zeke Edwards, both of whom are here in New York. The fall semester presentations included students from New York City and around the world discussing their perspectives about how the pandemic is affecting their work and the industries they hope to enter. Offerings from Professor Kyungi Pyun, who discussed pandemic life in the past as depicted in the Art History of Paris, and from Professors Yuni Karamura and Mark DeJong, who talked about their recent work on cultural appropriation. And a presentation by FIT alum, fashion historian, and independent curator, Darnell Jamal Lisby, who shared expertise in delineating the impact of Blackness within the history of fashion and in creating content that is physically reaches audiences and also intertwines subject matter that relates to current social issues. Globally Connected at FIT will launch its spring semester series in February with a presentation by Professor Jada Schumacher, as well as another session led by students from the Black Student Union. Full descriptions of the talks and the speakers, along with the dates and times, can be found on the Globally Connected at FIT webpage. The Gladys Marcus Library, in collaboration with students and faculty from Fashion and Textiles and Visual Display and Exhibition Design programs, has launched the multimedia, multidisciplinary online exhibition, Max Mayer and A. Beller and Company, Interpreting a Hidden History of New York City's Garment District. This exhibition focuses on historical fashions from 1910s and 1920s, presenting fashion illustrations from the library's special collections and college archives, and period garments from the Fashion and Textile Studies Garment Study Collection, highlighting their relationship to each other, the industry, and FIT's founding father, Max Mayer. The library has also expanded its virtual resources to include the Love Your Library Maker's Mind series, with 7 events scheduled for Common Hour during the spring. Virtual office hours offered each day by the library faculty. A variety of new video tutorials and library synchronous and asynchronous instructional sessions to include videos on the library's YouTube channel that can easily be embedded in your Blackboard course shell. And the library's program showcasing scholarship and creativity in the FIT community, which this spring offers 3 online events featuring Professors Ann Kong, Brenda Cowan, and Carly Spina with Helen Lane. As is a tradition at the start of each semester, the CET Faculty Workshop, it's your first day of class, will be held tomorrow, Friday, January 22nd, from 10 a.m. until noon, with a focus on tips for teaching, the syllabus, and strategies for remote teaching and learning. Invitations have been sent to the faculty via email. Please check the CET website calendar for other upcoming Teaching Center events and activities, as well as if you are seeking assistance using FIT's digital syllabus template for any of your classes. You will also find the recording of last semester's special event entitled Designing with Music with Dan Teffler. Our Office of Online Learning and Academic Technologies announces that it is now offering Acclaim badges to instructors who complete training or who refresh their online courses. These badges may be shared digitally on sites like LinkedIn and Blackboard. To date, the office has awarded 231 badges to those who completed online instructor training, 62 to trained blended instructors, and 16 to online instructors who have refreshed their older online courses. Participation in our remote teaching workshops remain robust throughout the fall, with a total of 221 faculty attending sessions that included Blackboard Basics, Teaching Live with Blackboard Collaborate, Creating Lecture Videos with Screencast-O-Matic, Remote Teaching Essentials, and others. These workshops will continue throughout the spring, beginning on Monday, January 25th. Please visit the Teach Remotely site for a list of 5 online workshops, as well as the most up-to-date tutorials for Blackboard and related tools and recordings of previous live online sessions. For those of you who would like to brush up on your remote teaching skills, the remote teaching course offered this past summer is still available as a resource on your Blackboard homepage. This 10-hour course presents comprehensive training videos on remote teaching pedagogy, synchronous and asynchronous teaching strategies, recommended tools, and building effective presentations. 292 instructors have completed the course to date. Throughout the spring, we'll also be continuing our training program for new online instructors, as well as our advanced training program for instructors who already have online teaching experience, featuring topics such as advanced Padlet, active learning strategies, and universal design. And finally, I'm pleased to note that our online and blended course offerings continue to increase. During the current academic year, the college is running a total of 636 online sections and 66 blended sections, which represent increases since last academic year of 82 sections in the online category and 15 sections in the blended category. In addition, the office has trained 16 new online instructors this past fall, bringing the total number of trained online instructors to 231. Two new blended teaching instructors were trained as well, bringing that total to 64. The pandemic has certainly not in any way hindered our continued efforts and success of FIT faculty and staff in the pursuit of grant opportunities. Several notable awards were received during the fall semester, with a continuing strong emphasis on innovation and interdisciplinary collaboration. These awards included three major federal awards that speak to the diversity of our various campus projects. First, a National Endowment for the Humanities grant in the amount of $150,000 that was awarded for a project entitled Shop Girls into Show Girls, New Resources on New York's Working Class for Community College Students. This is a three-year curriculum-focused NEH Humanities Connection for Community Colleges project led by Kyungi Pune from History of Art in partnership with Vincent Kwan from Fashion Business Management and Rebecca Bauman from Modern Languages and Cultures. Daniel Levinson-Wilk from Social Sciences will be contributing additional expertise to the project as well. A Save America's Treasures grant in the amount of $83,000 from a federal consortium that includes the National Park Service, the Institute for Museum and Library Services, and the National Endowment for the Humanities. This grant has been awarded to the Gladys Marcus Library for the unique project entitled Seventh Heaven, Preserving FIT Records from the Garment District, which will be led by Karen Trevett, Head of Special Collections and College Archives. And finally, a grant in the amount of $25,000 has been awarded in support of the project entitled Unconventional Innovation, Design for a Sustainable Future, which encompasses this spring's FIT sustainability conferences, as well as sustainability-focused programs throughout the year. The project is being led by Karen Pearson from Science and Mathematics, in partnership with Joanne Arbuckle, Deputy to the President for Industry Partnerships and Collaborative Programs, and acting dean for the School of Graduate Studies. Additional grant awards included a Cotton in the Curriculum grant in the amount of $50,000 to the Textile Development and Marketing team led by Ajor Sarkar, a $15,000 grant from the French Embassy's Transatlantic Mobility Program to Helen Gaudet from OIP in partnership with Jean-Marc Rayaud from AMC, a SUNY Prepare Innovation Grants Program grant in the amount of $10,000 made possible through the SUNY Chancellor's Office. The team on this project, entitled PPE Design for Diverse Bodies, includes Ajor Sarkar from TDM, Amy Sperber from Fashion Design, Peter Chan from Production Management, and Karen Pearson from Science and Mathematics, who is also serving as the project's PI. FIT is one of only seven SUNY campuses to receive this inaugural grant, which was awarded at the maximum amount. And finally, a grant from the Academy of Korean Studies in the amount of $22,700 to Kyungi Pune from History of Art. Remaining connected with our students in this remote environment is especially important. And in this regard, the Academic Advising Center will continue to partner with faculty on the Early Alert Initiative, which, as you know, provides an important opportunity for the advising team and the faculty to use the Starfish Student Success platform to reach out to and engage with students who may be experiencing academic difficulties, as well as to encourage those students who are doing well. This semester, all faculty members will be sent a roster of their classes and will be offered an opportunity to complete the Student Progress Report survey on a voluntary basis if they desire to do so. The Academic Skills Tutoring Center and Writing and Speaking Studio will also be providing additional academic support for students by collaborating to offer peer-to-peer sessions on how to use Blackboard and other remote teaching platforms, guiding them in navigating platforms, highlighting features, finding information, and handing in assignments. This support will be offered from Monday through Saturday from 8 a.m. to 2 p.m. and from 5 p.m. to 9 p.m. for the first 2 weeks of the semester. Students can also seek help throughout the semester by signing up for individual sessions on organizing your digital life. For more information, please visit the Tutoring Center or the Writing and Speaking Studio website, or contact Brian Fallon or Deborah Levine. And finally, you will be pleased to know that in spite of a fall semester slowdown on the number of contests and projects due to the pandemic, early signs are showing that contest activity is rebounding for the spring, with 6 projects already confirmed and 5 more that are in various stages of planning. In closing, then, let me remind you that the dates and times for your individual schools meetings can be found in the convocation announcement that you received towards the end of last week. I want to thank you all once again for attending today's event from afar, and especially for all of your continuing efforts to move forward during these challenging times. My warmest best wishes to you all for a rewarding and most productive semester. And I would now like to introduce the President of our Faculty Senate, Professor Calvin Williamson, who will offer welcoming remarks.
Thanks very much, Jack. It's an honor to be here today and to welcome you to Spring 2021. I want to start by congratulating you all on the fall semester. It was an incredible experience, like none we could have ever dreamed of. We ran several thousand classes, and most of us did not set foot inside a classroom. How did we do that? Was it a success? Was it a failure? I mean, I know some things we did or we tried to do. We all did them. Us and 4,000 other colleges and schools around the world. We recorded demos and lectures so students could access them at any time from anywhere. We made every document digital so there was no paper to hand out or take up. We squeezed 25 small boxes containing our students' heads onto these little screens on our computers. That actually turned out to be much harder than we thought. We insisted that the students show themselves when really it seemed like they just wanted to sleep or lie down or who knows what during lectures. We spent massive time trying to prepare our classes, which we've all taught hundreds of times before, just not quite in this way. I fully expected to be a complete failure at this. I thought that uniformly the students would not be happy, that they would complain, or worse, be indifferent and just bide their time during these classes with their cameras off and their heads down, not listening, not caring, not learning. And that did happen some. But something else happened as well. I don't know how to completely describe it or what to attribute it to. Some of the students in my classes told me that our class was their favorite class they had last semester. They said they looked forward to it. They emailed me after the class ended to say they would miss it. They said they really enjoyed the material. After the semester, I got a few emails. Normally, I get none. I actually was surprised because I didn't cover the material any differently. I wasn't more lucid in Google Meet than in the classroom. In fact, there were many technical difficulties along the way that made it more difficult to just have class as normal. Just normal discussions, looking around the classroom to gauge whether students were following or not. All these things became more difficult through this layer of garbled video and audio. So how could this semester have been so difficult, so much struggle, and so different from normal, yet there was so much positive about it? I've been thinking and thinking about this, as I am sure you have been as well. And I'm beginning to get some ideas, but honestly, I'm not exactly sure I know the answer yet. You can email me and tell me if you think you know. Because guess what? We're going to get the chance to do this all again starting next week. And I want to get those emails again in May. I had no idea what I was missing. I never felt more proud than this past semester. I never felt more convinced of how important it is to do what we do. There is something so fundamentally different about this year. And what about the world outside our classrooms? In our government, our society, and how we communicate with each other about politics, race, equity. Things seem like they've become so much more difficult lately. We struggle to make sense of just basic situations, like having an election or trusting those that lead our country. Who enforces law? Who enforces order? So I'm hoping there too that even with the overwhelming difficulty we struggle with now, we will begin to see the positive effects of that soon as well. We are all hoping for this. And so with that, I welcome you to spring 2021, and I wish you the best semester. And now, it's my privilege to introduce the president of the Fashion Institute of Technology, Dr. Joyce F. Brown.
Thank you, Calvin, and good morning. You know, as the year 2020 dragged to its dreadful end, I was one of millions, I'm sure, who could not wait to say good riddance and to welcome with a sliver of optimism a new year. After all, at that time, a vaccine was on the horizon. There was a looming sense of possibility, of recovery, of stability. Well, it has only been 3 weeks, and it has been, as we know, more challenging, more tense, and chaotic than ever. But the academic calendar prevails, and here we are nonetheless. We return to our good work and to our students. I hope you were able to get some rest on the break. You've been performing heroically since the start of the pandemic. You've demonstrated exceptional concern and focus and student-centeredness. It's been a struggle, but you carried on. Your ingenuity and your dedication, all focused on your students, have been exceptional. You persisted, so your students persisted, despite the chaos around us. Of course, that chaos and the fallout from this month's unfathomable threat to our democracy has been dominating my thoughts, and I'll get to that momentarily. But first, I would like to share some news of the college. I've been asked whether FIT will be dispensing the COVID-19 vaccine. And the answer is maybe. I'm equivocating because we have the approval to vaccinate, we just don't have the vaccine. As you probably know, New York City has not received the number of doses it needs, and we are among many sites that are currently without a supply. We continue to administer the COVID-19 test, however. The mandate from SUNY is that rather than administer the test biweekly to those who come to campus regularly, we will administer it weekly. Ann Miller, our tireless director of student health services, tells me that we have administered about 3,000 COVID-19 tests since October. So we will let you know if and when the vaccine arrives on campus and what our capability and our protocols will be. Earlier this week, Governor Cuomo unveiled his executive budget, which is the first step in determining the state budget for fiscal 2022, and of course, our own operating budget as well. Now, we're still reviewing the details, but I'm pleased to say that the news for SUNY and for us is not as bleak as we thought possible. So here are some of the highlights of the governor's proposals. State funding for base aid will not be reduced. However, as you may know, those funds are based on student enrollment, and we have had a 6% decline in enrollment. So there'll be a reduction in our state aid, but compared to what we had anticipated, it will still be better news than we had expected. In addition, the tuition assistance program, the TAP funding for students, will not be reduced. The 20% of state aid that was delayed in this past year and that comes to $1.2 million, that will be restored. We're going to be eager to see the city's preliminary budget and financial plan, which we expect by mid-February. So this is the information we have at this point. It is, of course, subject to change. The state legislature must vote to adopt the governor's budget. Traditionally, that takes place on April 1st, but this has been a rather untraditional year. But let me add one other piece of financial news, which is very good. The federal stimulus bill has allocated $11.1 million to FIT, $3.5 million of which will go directly to students, and we will receive very specific instructions about the expenses to which we can apply the balance of the funds. But all of this is much better news than we anticipated, and hopefully the final budget will keep these proposals in place. We're making progress on the new academic building, although a shovel has not yet gone into the ground. On the other hand, the site behind the Feldman Building, the courtyard where it's to be built, has been thoroughly cleared and construction barriers have been erected. DASNY issued contracts for both phases of the work, the foundation and the building construction, and contractors are on the site securing all the permits and approvals we need from the multiple city agencies. Drilling for asbestos behind Feldman actually started yesterday. Sadly, the trees near the site on 28th Street are being removed, but we have received assurances that they will be replaced once the work is done. Now, I remind you that the funds for this project are from the state and the city capital budgets and cannot be applied for any other purposes. If we do not build this building, we will forfeit the funds and they will go to another construction project elsewhere in the state. In many ways, the release of the funds for our building is a signal of support for FIT and for the revitalization of Chelsea. Now, last August at Convocation, I described a two-part project we were implementing to begin to combat the bigotry that continues to fester on our campus. There are a number of important campus-oriented components of our programming, including your participation in annual workshops addressing unconscious bias and discriminatory behavior. I'm pleased that many of you have already signed up as or completed the workshops. This, of course, is just one step of many that we must take in order to own our own behavior, because that behavior becomes our signature. It defines our community, and it either elevates or it stains our image as we go forward in a world that is changing all around us. We'll do a climate survey so that we are certain about the nature of the scope of the issues we need to address, and to ensure that we have a consensus about the need for change. We really cannot continue to just talk about it or undertake crisis intervention when the need arises. It's time to act, and it's time for change. The other part of our efforts has to do with addressing racial bigotry in the creative industries, where so many of our alumni are employed. Bias there cuts off opportunity for many, including our alumni of color, who either do not get hired or are left to languish in entry-level jobs. With our industry partners, we formed the Social Justice Collaborative at FIT with the very ambitious goal of upending the corporate cultures that stand in the way of real diversity within their walls. We were fortunate to be able to bring on Sherry Baker, an international marketing and brand building executive, to direct the program. I should stress that she's doing this pro bono. She's a good friend of the college, and she was good enough to say yes when I had the nerve to ask for her assistance. We're building a social justice institute today, but one with an eye on tomorrow. We're in it for the long haul, and we will make systemic changes in the corporate recruitment and hiring and advancement practices in the industries where our graduates seek employment and recognition. We're starting the behind-the-scenes work of developing infrastructure and procedures that assure accountability. And once these core metrics are in place, we'll be in a position to program and to effectively help transform the cultural, the corporate culture in the creative industries, which until now have been able to function without serious acknowledgement of their own lack of diversity, equity, and inclusion in their ranks or in their leadership. Now, this semester, we're moving into an exciting new stage of our strategic planning process. We're now in the fourth iteration of our strategic plan, which we reassess on a regular basis. In each of our plans, faculty have articulated the need for greater flexibility in the curriculum. At this stage, we have probably achieved as much in this area as we can without addressing the issue head on. At our most recent Planning Council meeting, faculty suggested that this is really at the core of the strategic direction the college should embrace going forward. So in order to address this initiative, I have formed a faculty committee to develop a collaborative and strategic approach to examining our curricular areas. The collective thoughts seem to crystallize around the concepts of more flexibility in the curriculum, more possibilities for transdisciplinary academic offerings, and more opportunities for students to engage in research or capstone projects with cross-disciplinary teams of students and faculty. The committee has 14 members, and its three co-chairs represent our undergraduate schools. Their charge is to develop proposals and recommendations to be submitted to the departmental curriculum committees and the appropriate faculty senate committees for consultation, such that the agreed upon recommendations can be submitted to the college-wide curriculum committee this spring or early fall 2021. It's an ambitious schedule, but if we are truly committed to this goal, I know that we can do it, and I'm prepared to support the work in any way that I can. Our annual Sustainable Business and Design Conference takes place this year on April 13th and 14th, so please make a note of it. The programming will extend till Earth Day, which is a week later. So this year, the theme is Makers in Action. And our guest speakers include Sustainability All-Stars Eileen Fisher and Stacey Flynn, who is an FIT alum, as well as CEO and co-founder of Evernew. You'll be receiving Save the Date notices next week with a link that will let you submit questions to them to address during the program. So I am sorry to say that at this point, all signs are that commencement will once again be virtual. We communicated this information to our graduating class last month so that they and their families could make or adjust their plans. For many students and for many families, this is devastatingly disappointing. For many of them, this will be the first college graduation in their family. Students look forward to the ritual of walking across the stage in a cap and gown, and families have waited generations to witness it. It's a milestone, and I know you understand that since so many of you have been on that stage with me when they march across filled with pride and joy. We explored every possible option that would allow us to schedule an in-person event. But state, city, and SUNY pandemic mandates, limited locations of sufficient size and availability in New York City, and numerous other issues all combined to create roadblocks that we just had no way to overcome. Now, I've promised the students that should the earth shift in some unforeseen way to make it possible to be in person, I will do everything within my power to make it happen. It just seems highly unlikely at this point. Whatever we do, we will do it in the best possible FIT style so that it will be festive and fun and certainly memorable. I cannot help but worry, though, and wonder, once these fresh new alumni leave our command, I know they'll be professionally prepared, but can anyone prepare them for the world they will enter? Have we done enough to help them? After almost a year of the pandemic and its related anxiety, isolation, and economic turmoil, after almost 4 years of congressional paralysis and growing national tribalism, were any of us prepared for the assault on the very heart of America 2 weeks ago? The grief that we have been suffering since then brought me back almost 20 years to another soul-shattering event, to 9/11. It was a time of unprecedented challenge. Those of you who were here will remember how this community came together Each professor, administrator, staff member, our building and grounds crews, our food service personnel, everyone worked tirelessly to keep our students and indeed the entire community safe, to provide comfort and counseling and consolation or just simply information. This sense of shared responsibility, compassion, and dedication was replicated famously throughout the city and the nation. It was a time of coming together, and oddly enough, it was a time of hope. What I remember most poignantly was the way the country was able to forget the differences among us, differences in race or ethnicity, nationality, religion, in order to forge bonds in a common cause and for a common good. At that moment, as newly vulnerable as we were, we appeared strengthened in our determination not to succumb to the kind of fear and panic that breeds blame and bigotry. It appears now that we were, at the very least, naive. The past very eventful and clamorous two decades have been pockmarked by anger, by extremism, incivility, war. Our hope that we could count on that early collective spirit of cooperation and compassion gradually dissipated, and these past two decades became a time in which too often unfocused fear turned us against or away from each other. Today, our country is in a dangerous place. Joe Biden said that, standing in the fields of Gettysburg just last October in the midst of his presidential campaign. Once again, he said, we are a house divided. And the world was shocked by the desecration of our Capitol building by mobs of anarchists when Robert Kennedy Jr. commented that democracy is messy and hard and never easy. I don't think this is what he had in mind. Our democracy is fragile. It is what Franklin Roosevelt once called a living thing, a human thing compounded of brains and muscles and heart and soul. But democracy cannot thrive in an environment of animosity and distrust. It must be nurtured, its principles taught and passed on to each new generation. It needs citizenship practiced by informed citizens daily and in good faith. On this score alone, I really do not envy our new president. I mean, how do you bring together a country so suspicious, so polarized, and so angry? While speaking at Gettysburg, President Biden offered the beginning of a solution. It starts, he said, with how we treat one another, how we talk to one another, how we respect one another. It's a sentiment we share, one you've heard me express repeatedly, often at convocation. It just seems to me that we've not mastered the ability to exercise civility and respect in our disagreements. But there is value in listening and learning and determining a path forward forged with respect for each other, the inclusion of differing points of view, and a deep and abiding respect for all of humanity. If that's the future we want for ourselves and for the students whom we nurture, then we must model it and practice it as we do democracy daily and in good faith. I do gain hope and inspiration, even in dark times, from being here at FIT. The creativity and brilliance of our students shine a light on the possibilities that the future holds. Last Friday, for instance, I observed five of our students, four from design and one from TDM, paired with six MIT engineering students in a presentation of solutions that they developed in a two-week workshop for their sponsor, which was New Balance. We saw amazingly inventive uses of polyethylene as a sustainable option for footwear, and in another project, the exciting potential of structural color-changing fibers. They were achievable, they were scalable solutions, and New Balance was thrilled. They were sophisticated, they were futuristic, and they gave a glimpse of the world that will be. I was beyond proud. And then last month, I learned that a team of FIT students took third place in this year's International Adobe Contest. Now, let me point out that this is a computer analytics contest. computer analytics, international in scope for both undergraduate and graduate students, most of whom come from select business schools throughout the world. This year, there were more than 1,600 entrants, and the top prize went to the Indian Institute of Technology. The other winners came from the business schools at the University of Chicago and UCLA. And then, in third place, there was FIT. So these are the things that keep me going at this work on a daily basis. And then there are all of those grants that you are being awarded, so many of them focused on the future. Last week, I received a note from one of the grant directors at the National Endowment for the Arts regarding that $25,000 grant that Jack mentioned earlier. She simply wanted to tell me how deeply the NEA admires and how much the NEA is inspired by the work of FIT. I'm inspired by it as well. In times of trouble, your work and the work of our students help to rekindle hopes for a brighter, better future, one in which each of us can find once again the compassion and cooperation that characterized the aftermath of 9/11 and forge bonds for a common good. So it is in that spirit that I welcome you back, and I look forward to our work together in the coming months.